John Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. We're here at TD's place for the update of this growing season. I know a lot of you guys want the date, so today is tentatively August 14th, but this will not be aired till later since I'm behind, so putting them up. But anyways, it's been, I don't know, not quite a month since I was here last time, and I want to share with you guys what's going on. Basically, TD's been working on some home projects, remodel projects, so he hasn't spent a whole lot of time with his girls, although he has done the absolute necessary things to continue so that they can flourish, right? So the main things he did, and check last episode down below, link down below, he did the foliar feed twice. He also did the compost tea twice. He's been watering every 3 days. He never got to 4 days, and then he hit them with the bug spray that I'll share with you guys in this episode twice as a preventative measure. He had no major bug outbreaks, but they're starting to pop with the white tips. So he doesn't want to spray after this because then you could mess up stuff bad. So he wants to get all that done before. He's also reapplied some bug traps for the pitcher bugs that'll get in and kind of eat the plants out, like literally the stalk. And other than that, he's just been like still, you know, training them to grow out. And as you guys can see, they look really nice. They're just really tall and basically they're just big bushes. So what I want to do next for you guys is actually take you guys around with TD, and he'll give you a personal update on what he's been doing and how each of the girls are growing. All right, first plant we got the vanilla cream pie in the 6 foot hole. We'll see the vanilla cream pie in the 9 foot hole in a little bit. And this one's probably, the cage is at 8 feet, so it's pushing almost 9, maybe like 8.5 feet. And the hole is 6 feet if you look at the bottom, and it's extending past the width of the hole. So you guys could see it's probably about 9 feet wide. So TD, how is this girl doing?
She's actually, her and the other one are running pretty much close to the same. The other one's a little bit bigger, but overall, if you do all the work for the hole and stuff, stick with the 6 to 7 foot hole rather than going the 9.5 foot hole. It's a lot more work, and if you've got the same phenotypes, you're gonna have pretty much the same results.
So that's the update so far. Yeah, so far. We don't see the yield yet.
Yeah, we haven't seen the ending yet. But look how much this one pulled to the sun. She's a puller.
Yeah, you can see it like totally bent towards the sun right there.
And that's not us, that's just her. She's just like doing it.
It's all day, right?
Yeah, well...
Oh, look at this. This is like really bent, like right there. You can just see totally stretching.
Wherever the sun goes, she follows. She's my biggest follower out here. She's just like...
She's the biggest follower.
She is. She's always following that sun.
Which one of you guys are my biggest follower? All right. So what have you been doing, TD, as you come out, besides just, you know, the watering and the spraying and all that stuff?
Like I said, at the end of July, we're pretty much done tying them down. So I'm pretty much just looking for the ones that are ready to come through the cage. For instance, like right here, I haven't been out here much this year because I've been working really hard, but ones like this that need to come through, this one will come through soon, maybe now. But there's a lot of them to keep coming through, to keep pulling the plant over. And as we keep pulling it over, we open up that top inside.
And then you could see they're starting to like make some baby, starting to show, you know?
Yeah, and there's times in here, well, I'll probably show you better on the other vanilla cream pie, where I can lift up the net and move her over towards me more. I use the nets, like I said, to scrog them out. And so there's times like, and other times when you're out here, don't just walk around and look at them here. You got to get down here. There's stuff that needs to be pulled out down in here that's like right in here. But you'll see they just keep coming through. So just keep helping them out, getting them out the cage for support for when they get flowering big.
All right, the next plant is the new, and you guys can see it's probably about 7 feet tall, maybe pushing 7.5. And then, but it's like fat on the bottom. It's really weird. So it's like probably
9 feet, yeah.
9 feet on the bottom. And then you can see it's got like an apple bottom because it like comes out, or a pear bottom. The top's kind of skinny. So TD, how's this girl been growing?
She's doing awesome, actually. She's really a nice full plant. She's going to have those damn big buds again. I can almost tell you that already because she has flowers everywhere inside here. So... but other than that, I like big butts. You like
big butts? I like big butts, and I cannot lie.
She has a big butt. But yeah, she's doing really awesome. I was told by a partner that's grown this before that In order for it to get 14 foot tall, it has to have perfect conditions. So like whatever. I was expecting a huge plant out of it, but if as long as it goes really wide, that's what I look
that's
for.
That's most
anyways.
Important
yeah.
thing. Yeah.
So I mean, it's getting out there. Maybe we'll get 14 wide. That'd be more awesome. 14 tall.
Yeah, it's looking really nice. All filled in, really good.
And if
nice
you see,
and tight.
No bugs.
Yeah, no nobody bugs, no nothing. Yeah.
Nobody home. You'll see a fly or two every now and then still, but those cocksuckers are everywhere, you know that.
So why do you preventative spray it? Would you recommend that or just do it automatically
yeah,
or not?
Just to make sure that you gave it one last shot, just because what I did twice this year too is I did a neem oil south suds to the soil. And that also helps the plant absorb the neem oil, and it also helps prevent for the bugs too.
And didn't you put like neem meal into the soil mix too?
Yeah, but still I just gave it a little extra preventative this year.
And when did you do that spray? Because that's different, right?
I did one of those at the beginning of the year, and I did one of them just recently.
All right.
I just wanted to make sure, just double check everything this year, you know what I mean?
Yeah, make sure it has the neem coursing through its veins.
Yeah, I don't want no more problems. The neem oil is cheap, it's not that expensive.
Yep.
And right it's on. 100% organic, so.
Right on. All right, next up we got the white Runtz, and it's basically just popping out of the edges of the cages a little bit. So it's probably about 6.5 feet wide, about 7 feet tall. And TD, how's the white Runtz growing?
She's doing really well. She was the smallest one, and now she's one of the, she's in the medium,
medium
class.
Medium, yeah.
She's not small no more though. She's definitely a really nice plant, really nice and filled out too.
Oh yeah, I got the twin towers up top, man. You want to talk about that? How come you got like two towers
coming out the
top? All right,
this is the only plant that actually showed that we left the fifth node this year, and we grew five. And remember I said we'd let them go straight up, and this is the only plant that's actually showing signs of it. But I thought it was pretty cool that it actually showed the twin towers.
Mm.
I'll bet you they're two big ass bombs when we're done. But she's doing really well. She's definitely bypassed my friends. My friend's like, I knew I should have kept that one. And I'm like, oh,
but it's
God.
Not the key. It's not that he kept it. It's your growing practice, man.
You're
giving him more love.
Him. You got to stretch him.
Yeah.
I mean, even though I haven't given him as much time as I usually do, I still come out here and do my thing as much as possible. See, here's one of those things in the net that I'm talking about right here. This, you can just use the net to move it over. And then now it'll stay over there. And see, we just keep walking them this way.
Yeah, keep walking them out.
To the outer side, yeah.
Yeah.
Walk them on out. Leave the two in the middle alone, though, so you don't stretch that camberum down below and stuff. I left them, even when I put the second and third net on, they're still going straight up. I left them alone the whole time. And it really did a big difference, because I've noticed over all the years that I've done just four nodes and pulled them down, I always get that little hole. And I was assuming it was mainly bugs, but I'm really leaning towards it stretching the fibers out, and that's why they're opening it up.
So way better to have five.
Yep, or if you want to go four, let the fourth node go straight up, you know, because it's a lot easier to handle. Five nodes is no big deal if you just let the two go straight up, though. I recommend five. It worked out really well this year. I have no tree seal on anybody. There's no holes in the tops, and they actually... you could probably see best on that one right there, the new. It has really big, nice knots at the top. So it has really too thick a fiber to be chewing on. You
cool.
know?
All right, next up we got the Glookies. And this girl has grown really wide out the back side of the cage. About 9.5 wide and about 8 feet tall. So how's the Glookies been growing for you, TD?
This one's been doing actually really, really great. Like I told you, remember in the last video I said she was growing like 1.5 inches a day? You can tell because she's catching up to everybody. She might be the biggest one in the end here. She's definitely got the nicest branches. She's got really good thick branches. She has good node stretch in between her budding, so they won't be colas, huge ass colas. So they should be decent size and still have more of a twist style rather than, you know, those big ass colas we talked about last time. They don't work out around here. It ain't that we wouldn't like to grow those. It's just they don't work out in the moisture. But she's the one that you said you didn't know about. Remember, I don't know about her.
Yeah, it wasn't looking too good early. And look at her now.
I told you, she'll spread her legs.
Yeah. But actually what I want to talk about besides the legs is actually the trunk. So I'm gonna show this trunk, TD. So you want to talk about like the importance of having a big, wide, girthy trunk there.
Thicker than Camberlin.
Yeah, thicker cambium layer. And yep. I mean, how does somebody get a girthy trunk, man? Like, what do they do to get your girth on that trunk?
Just follow the steps that we've done.
Follow the steps we've done. Yeah.
Yep. I've led you all the way I can. And when we get to the stupid fruits, you'll see, don't get discouraged if you do grow a small one with these techniques, because there's some plants that don't perform for you all the way. This Glookies is a great plant. Yeah, I mean, if it was me, it's from Barney's, remember? Barney's Seed Company. It's a great plant, though. It started off a little weird looking, kind of like what I call a spider or octopus look. And then before you know it, the branches, if you notice, are so girthy, they grew really big branches. Some of these, this isn't even a main branch, I guarantee you. This is just a branch off a branch. I lost track of this one a long time ago. I really did. I pulled all the ropes. If you see, there's no ropes for this one no more, because I pulled them a long time ago when she started just branching out like crazy. She's one of the only ones that, this year, I only topped everybody one time. I never topped again this year. Only the two main colas on the way up, and that was it. And so there was no real topping. It's all just pulling and tucking leaves and standing them in places where I wanted them and just stretching them out, scrogging them good.
Yeah, stretching them out. Yeah, you've been stretching better on the back. Or why do you think it's growing better on the backside?
I don't know. She's doing really, really well back here, though. This is the first time ever that the non-sun side did so well. I'm really stoked, though, because the sun side will pick it up. Like I said last time, I never worry about her. She's doing that good. Yeah, she's an incredible plant, though. I'll probably grow this one more time. But next year, we're going to grow the incredible bulk in the big pot, really see what's up. We got to get back to her. But Glookies, she's a great plant, don't get me wrong. I like it so far. Like I said, it doesn't have just buds stacked on buds, so you don't have those huge-ass colas.
Yep, looking really nice so far. All right, let's take a look at the stupid plant this year, which is only 6.5 wide, maybe about 6.5 tall. This is the Stoopid Fruits.
Stoopid Fruits from Humboldt Seeds.
Humboldt Seeds. So TD, what's up with the Stoopid Fruits? Why is it so small using your techniques, man?
What's up? She doesn't, this plant's been different the whole time I've been growing it. It's been going, we've talked about it's going in and out of the yellow tip stages. These will all be green next time you come. It's really weird how it goes in and out. I've never seen such a thing.
I mean, something's stressed out
and
or something's going on.
It never really is as perky as the rest of the plants. If you noticed in the videos, if you look at the rest of the plants, they're all straight up like this towards the sun. One's even stretching over to the side, the vanilla cream pie. This one never really pulls. So in my eyes,
stretching a little bit.
I think that it has a small root system. I don't think it has a very good root system. And I'm not blaming it on Humboldt Seeds. I'm just stating that I don't think the plant itself got itself a good root system.
Yeah, it could just be like, you might have got a dud.
Yeah.
I mean, the other thing is like the weather conditions too, you know?
Yeah,
I mean,
it might not like this area.
It might not like this particular area or your specific, I mean, it should like the soil and all the practices. I mean, the other plants show it.
Yes.
So it's just the climate zone, something is a little bit maybe too hot, I don't know.
Yeah, it doesn't like heat at all.
That's
every
the problem.
Every time it says heat, it goes whoop.
I mean, today is like 90 degrees and it's not.
And you know, we've had a lot of viewers out there ask, you know, what plants should I grow in the heat and stuff like that. If it was me and I was to grow one in the heat, the rain, the sun, any place that is extreme weather conditions, it'd be the incredible bulk. It can withstand so much weather conditions, it's amazing. I would definitely try that one, and it's great smoke or whatever you want to do with it. It's a great plant. I'm going to be going back to her again next year because I want to put her in the 9-foot 6 hole. I want to see what she's got in that.
Where do people get the seeds for that one?
I get those online on OA Seeds.
OA Seeds.
Yeah, OA Seeds companies. I know other people are like, you can get them here in the States or whatever, but whatever. OA Seeds has over 2,500 varieties, over, I think, 310 different seed banks on there. So I go with them, and they've always been really well with me. They always gave them to me in the package. Like the new, we don't even really know, like I've stated in the other videos, if we have the new, because I ordered that from Herbie Seeds Company. And Herbie's didn't give it to me in the original packaging, stating that they stealthed it to me, which they only put it in a crayon package. Like, oh, that's really stealth. Then when you get it from OA Seeds, you'll get them, these were actually bought over the counter, but you'll get them in like sewn in backpacks, stuff like that, you know? So they're really
hardcore.
Yeah. They're not lying about it. And you get the original packaging. So I stick with OA Seeds. Mm. Yep. But these were over the counter because we had the slip and fall. So these are actually 10 days behind all of these plants.
Yeah, the normal.
Yep. They would have been 10 days bigger.
Yeah, timing is everything, man. Maybe if you put them in earlier, that maybe they would be doing better, you think?
Well, if we go too much earlier, they'll go into, they'll think that they need the flower.
Yeah,
so then they'll go into where, it's like a shock because they'll go into three leaf pattern and they'll start flowering. And so you don't want to do that. If you could do that, you're going to have to put them under lights. And then I don't like doing that either because I get more scrawnier like plants for me. You know, other people, it works out and they're happy with them. If you're happy with what you do, that's up to you. But for me, I like to just start them at the last weekend of March, February, first weekend of March, one or the other. Just take a date, pick it. You know, if you have good weather, go for it. If you don't start before the last weekend of February and the first weekend of March, because they'll flower on you, guaranteed.
That's for this area, of course, because depending
on
where you live.
Do a photo period no matter what, because
I see.
Yeah, you have to have at least 12 hours of light. When they're really, really young, it's not as critical, you know what I mean? But if you did it at the beginning of February, I think, what, it's 9 hours of light? So they're automatically thinking flower. You're probably making them think that they're an auto. You know?
All right, so here we got the vanilla cream pie in the 9'6" hole. You can see the other vanilla cream pie over yonder. And this girl is about 8 feet tall and probably like a good solid 9 feet wide. So TD, why do you grow them so wide, man, for those of the viewers that haven't been keeping up to date with all your grow information?
Wider, I like them wider than taller because I like the big bushes. Got them infested, trying to get her over here. I like the big bushes and it airs them out more. You get more air inside there and you get more plant. I mean, there's a lot of plant here. This is a big plant, this one. But I think that the Glookies is going to overtake her.
Oh, really?
By the end of the season, I think Glookies will do it because Glookies is still on a roll and this one's already. Now, she's stretching pretty good because she's going into flower really hard. Like, she might be flowering more than any other one so far.
Oh, really?
Yeah. She's got good white caps on her already. But she's stretching like crazy, but she's not pulling like the other vanilla cream pie. Look, she's going more towards like, just like gradually still up.
Not stretching too much.
She's got one bent
little
right here,
bit.
But yeah.
So you want to talk about the phenotypes, man? Like, because some people may not know they grew the two of the same plants and they're totally different.
Yeah.
A little bit different.
These are probably two different phenotypes, I'm assuming. So what I'm assuming is one's going to taste more like vanilla cream pie, like the pastry, and one's going to taste more like the sweet diesel or however they said it. So.
And those are the parents.
Yeah, and I would say this one, the parents are Fire OG, so that's probably the sweet diesel.
I see.
So this one I would say is going to be more on the Fire OG side. And the other one's going to be more on the other phenotype. But it's Ghost OG, I think the other one is. Sorry, I was trying to think of it. The other one would be more towards the Ghost, so it would be more towards the vanilla cream pie flavor. So they get two different flavors and smells from these. They get a slight fuel, I guess, towards the end of the, I guess, at the end, no matter what they say on these plants, they get a slight fuel smell. So we're going to find out what a slight fuel smell smells like. Hopefully they keep smelling like vanilla cream pie pastry. But I was told by one of the viewers, I believe it was, he said that it didn't taste like vanilla cream pie, but it was a really, really good plant. He said he was really happy with it at the end.
Cool. And you want to talk about the 9'6" hole, like all the work you did to do it? Would you do that again? I mean, what are your thoughts on the big hole, man?
It's twice as hard to do everything in this hole. Like, for instance, once the cage is on, it's a hassle. Like, you got to get the yellow card sticky traps underneath there. I have to crawl underneath there to do it. You can see where I crawled around. I hate doing that because the feeder roots are on top too, you know?
Yeah, messing up the roots, man. You don't really want to get in there and mess that stuff up.
So the other plants, I could reach from the outside over the railing itself, clothespins and all, and reach in and change it. I just got to just keep going around the plant. But this plant, I literally just stayed inside and crawled around it because what am I going to do, you know? I'm like crawl in, crawl out, crawl in, crawl out. But overall, it's really, the only thing that I see different in this plant is it's a lot more healthier to me because it doesn't have a lot of skinny offshoots. The other one has a lot more skinnier offshoots. This one's really thick. Not thick like Glookies in the back though. But she has a definite good foundation for her flowering. The other one over there makes me a little nervous, like I might have to support her a lot more because she's got a lot of skinny sticks in places, you know. It's definitely gonna probably have to drape it. We'll find out, hopefully not.
You wanna talk about that real quick? You got your little stick there and what are you doing there?
She was hanging up on the edge right there, and when they're flowering like that, I don't like that. So I just kind of bend the cage a little bit, reach up in there with my thing, and I can put her wherever I want. So I want her right there because now she's nice and straight and she's not leaning on it.
I see.
Kind of help them through. I know, I'm anal.
Well, that's why you get the results you do, man. And yeah. Most people are just slacking and just get what they get because they're not doing all the work.
But if they get way in there and you can't do it, that's why the knock's on there. The knock will actually get right by one of the branches and you can push it wherever you want.
The knock. So yeah, where he's using actually an upside down arrow. So it's got like a little knock on the tip, which is where they put the little string.
And at times, if I want to like lift that net to move one,
I'll use one
arrow on one side and use another arrow to move it over. Because they will get full.
All right, so now I want to talk about the preventative bug spray that TD has been using. He did, you know, the soil drench twice, like he talked about a little bit earlier, and then he also has done, since I've been here last, two times on the spraying of this out. And you'll basically do this the following day after feeding, doing the foliar feed spray. He'll basically mix up a batch of 10 gallons total of this mixture, and the recipe is 2 tablespoons of neem oil to 2 tablespoons of salicylate soap to 1 gallon of pure filtered water. So he'll basically use like 20 tablespoons of each of these in 10 gallons of water. I'd recommend you guys use like hot water to get the neem kind of to like kind of like dissolve a little bit, because with the heat it kind of gets a bit more thin. It's too thick if it's too cold. And then at the end, put in the salicylate soap, because you put the soap in first, then you fill it with water, then it's gonna make a lot of suds. And then he puts it basically in his sprayer that he wheels around in his cart. Once again, link down below to that video. I mean, this is the video I have. I'll put a link down below to the video I made with Josh on the neem and salicylate soap. And that was my go-to organic spray when I had a bug outbreak. That being said, these days, my goal is to not spray this on my plants, but to improve my soil practices, you know, increase the beneficial insects in my garden so that I don't have to spray or have any kind of, you know, even organic sprays unless I have an outbreak. So you have to determine if you want to, you know, do a preventative spray like TD. Maybe you might want to if you're following his exact goals and his pattern, because hey, if it helps you to prevent a bug outbreak before it occurs, man, it saves your crop. I think that's a good thing. I think the final thing we want to do today is we're going to go ahead and sit down with TD and ask him a few questions about this month's update. All right, so now I have the pleasure of interviewing TD. We're going to ask him a few questions about his grow and answering some of the questions that he saw on previous videos. So TD, the first question is, why do you twist your plants?
I twist them. I've been asked that question a few times now. And I like to twist to get the shoots to come up straight. So if you twist it to the left and to the right and to the left, it's 3 twists at one time, then you'll push all the shoots straight up and they'll be on their way up.
So you're kind of training them to grow straight up by twisting
Correct.
Them.
And I'm not like twisting them all the way around. I'm twisting them. The leaves themselves, you'll see there's 2 leaves on each side, twist them upright, twist them upright.
So what like angle or whatever, degrees?
I'd say it'd be 80 degrees.
So not quite 90.
90 degrees.
Not about 80 or 90 degrees.
Yeah, because you're just going to turn them to where everybody's flat. You know, to where everybody's going straight up, the shoot-wise, not the leaves, the shoots.
The shoots.
The new shoots.
And then that, what does that do for you?
That's how we get bushy and round and get, every new branch that we can gather outside those cages, like I said, the little cage, once you get outside there, everything inside's pretty much gone, so you don't have to worry about those. Even they'll even regrowth on you down there, so you have to really check. Like I said, it's good to not just walk around your plants, look from underneath too and look up at them so you see what's going on underneath them too. Besides, you'll see if there's any bug infestation, cobwebs, whatever. Yeah. You know, there's a lot of things that happen underneath that you don't see from standing up.
And if you did not twist them, how would these plants look now?
What would happen is you would get one shoot at a time, probably, and the other shoot would probably be dead. Not dead, but you'd cut it off later.
Because it wouldn't really do much.
Yes, because it doesn't get enough light. Mm. So as soon as you turn it towards the light, then you have two up going straight up at the light.
I see.
And you got to train them to go out so they're not together all the time, you know what I mean? So you don't just pay attention to the branch itself, the shoots themselves too.
So this causes basically more, of course, flowering sites, more bushiness, and more flowers in the end, right?
Correct.
So like, what do you think, twice as much if you did?
Oh, at least 2 to 3 times the yield.
To 3 times more just for that one thing.
Not even twisting.
Not even pinching, just twisting.
All the plants that you've seen this year have only been pinched that one time, like I talked about.
But you've been twisting like every day.
And
well, not quite, but.
Yeah, twisting all the time, yep. Twisting and turning, now we're done. We'll talk about that in a second, but only ones that I pinched though were the two main, the number fifth notes. That's the only ones I pinched this year. Every other node, I just let go. I just pulled and just trained it. I'm not a pincher. Like other people are pinchers, like we've talked before. I'm not a pincher, and the way I look at it, like for instance, this one right here, how her branches are a little bit thinner than I like. Well, if I was to pinch her, could you imagine how thin they'd be? They'd be a little everywhere, not just in some spots, they'd be everywhere. So I'd really be worried then, like, oh my God, how much net do I need? The whole 100 feet?
And let's talk about like pinching. So at what point did somebody stop pinching?
Well, I would pinch as soon as I started seeing the lady parts that you were looking at the other day where you saw the hairs first starting. You know, when you were here last video, the hairs were just starting. I would definitely stop pinching.
You'd stop pinching when you saw hairs.
There's certain strains that you can pinch during flower, they recommend it. Very few that I've read up on that have ever said it, but I've come across a few that have said it. I've never grown them myself personally because I'm not a pincher.
And that's not what you do anyways. Yeah.
Yeah.
And what if you start, if you pinch too late, what'll happen?
You'll probably turn it to where it starts to like stress out to where it'll go into a quick three leaf thing instead of going down. Like they're going to start narrowing back down to 5 leaves here soon. And they've been all the way up to what, 13 we counted this
year?
Yeah, and they'll go all the way back down to 5. And matter of fact, I think she's only at 7 now.
Yeah, because now they're worried about flowering, not making any more
leaves.
They're
concentrating on flowering, yeah.
So, okay, so let's ask this. So, because they're concentrating on flowering now, they're going into flower, are you changing your nutrient program?
No, now I'm not even going to give them anything else from here on out. I've already gave them everything pretty much throughout the year and the milk and stuff. And then, so for this year, I just gave them the last of the boogie brew stuff that I had. So I'm pretty much just gonna, like, at the hardener, I gave them all the banana juice that I had. I make my own banana.
When did you give them the banana juice?
I just did it this beginning of last week when I saw it.
So we didn't even talk about that. Yeah, so
yeah.
Links down below to the video for last season where we talked about the banana juice.
Banana tea.
Banana tea.
Yep.
Right.
But I gave them that and they only got, like, I think it's like 4 gallons a piece because I only had like 32 gallons, something like that. But I'm not going to give them anything else this year. Everything is going along so well. And I just want to make sure that I don't overdo it. You know what I mean? I should probably check the Brix level is what I should do.
Of the leaves?
Yep.
Yep. And what if the Brix is too low or too high, what will you do differently?
I don't know. I'd have to read up and find out. I'd be nervous to know, actually, because... when my buddy tested them a long time ago, he said I had great brick levels. I think it was 6-7.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he said that was really good. I don't really know a lot about them.
I see. Yeah, I don't know what the bricks... I know there's bricks charts for vegetables and fruits, and I know those.
Yeah.
But I have no idea about cannabis, but I know you could measure it.
Yeah, I had a buddy actually do it. That's how I know. And he told me they were really, really good. He says, you're doing really good. And I'm like, oh, thanks. You know, because I didn't know. I was like, whoa, what is that thing he's all looking through?
Yeah, the bricks basically measures the total dissolved solids, including minerals and sugars in the plant. And generally, the higher the bricks, probably in the end, the more flower you're going to get. And also
more
just
flavor.
And more flavor. I mean, you're going to get more everything.
Yes, yep.
Because the plant's just showing you that it's healthy and it's just... you know, not too low, and it's showing that you got a good soil program, because if you have a crappy soil program, your bricks is going to be low, like conventional produce not grown well is like really low. Like on produce, it's like poor, good, average, excellent, right?
Yes, yeah.
And like when I like to eat fruits and vegetables, like, yeah, today I was at the farmer's market, and I was like, poor, because my taste buds are my best bricks meters. Like, you could taste some stuff and yep. you know, like, oh, this is good stuff or not, right? So that's how we really should be doing it. And we should, I think, you know, people into agriculture should take this into consideration, you know, the bricks levels to see how they could, you know, tweak it and get it higher. And once again, better quality, more yield in the end, more flavors. All right, TD, another question a viewer had was, when do you stop tying down? Like, are you actually right now, you stopped tying down actually, right?
Yes, I did at the end of the July because to me, once they start flowering, there's no more real training that you can really do, because if you start like pulling them too much, like I'll move them and stuff, but I won't really train them anymore. Like I'm not pulling them down and stuff because we're gonna start resting them on the flowers themselves, and we don't wanna do that. They've pretty much reached the cages by now. If they haven't reached the cages, then they're gonna have to reach it and do their own thing, because they're flowering, you know, they're way beyond training. They're gonna have one final stretch. They'll probably grow for another 3.5 to 4 weeks, and they'll be done stretching, guaranteed. But they're gonna go through a pretty good stretch right now. This will be their stretch time.
So it sounds like once they go to flower, like you pretty much, you water still every 3 days, you lay off all the foilers and compost teas, even like
any... Pretty much we have everything in there.
Yeah, so like you're really just kind of like, just inspect them every day.
Yep, make sure there's no bug infestations, no powder mildew. I mean, we've still had pretty wet mornings here.
Oh yeah.
The fog has just been crazy. But they're all doing really, really well, and that's another reason to change those cards once a month too. On the bottom around the
sticky traps, for because you're trying to catch the earwigs.
Yeah, and they get dense.
So you get and they get messed up.
Yeah. And another thing, when I make those traps down there, not only do I cut the card in half, but everywhere where you pull it, you have to cut that part off too, because you still give them a little place to cross. And I staple them all together.
Mm.
So I make the whole row. It takes seven cards to go around there.
I see.
So yeah, so each time you open it up, you only have to cut the top of one. The other bottom part can stay there.
You paste it on the other one.
And then I just staple it. Yeah, I use a stapler. And I staple the whole ring. So there's literally only one clothespin really holding the last one together.
I see, because it's like a tape. So if they had tape like that,
correct,
then you'd be in good shape.
But you definitely got to get rid of that one little part, because if they happen to find that one little part where you pull
it, get through.
Yeah, so just cut it off, and it's easier on you anyways. It's cleaner, it's nicer.
And you've had no known pincher bug damage that you're aware
of? No, I can't even find bugs this year. I'm so stoked. I'm like really happy. Everything's working really, really well.
So, TD, the last question I have for you today is, you know, do you pH test your soils? I know in most cannabis grows, they are pH testing all the time so they can balance it and all this kind of stuff. What's your pH, man?
To be honest with you, I haven't checked it in over 2 years.
2 years? Yeah. Are you out of your mind?
I have all slow soluble nutrients that I give them. I don't give them chemicals, so I don't really think that my pH is going to rise that much. And I haven't seen no damage, no nothing that makes me worried about what's going on with the soil. I mean, the plants are doing fine. You know, so I don't believe that. Yes, I used to check it. I have a pen that checks it. I went to check it since I've had so many viewers ask that question, and the pen with the batteries were dead. So.
You don't even know.
So I still don't know to this day, but I know that the pH level's fine. And I heard that a lot of people have checked it because of the Boogie Brew filters. They say it rises the pH level a little bit. So I will get the pen working to see if that's really true. Test my water before and then test it after it goes through the filter.
Right, it depends on the water quality, like if it's really hard and all the minerals in there, because the Boogie Brew's not really taking out any significant amount of minerals, so.
Exactly, so I don't understand how the pH went up.
Yeah, you know? So I don't, but you know, here's the thing for me, because like people ask me, what's my pH in my garden, right? And like TD, like I have no clue, I have a pen, but I've never used it.
Yep.
And like to me, it's like a moot point. Like if you're growing with synthetic fertilizers where you could burn stuff and you're gonna imbalance your pH because you're playing God literally,
yep,
like using all the synthetic stuff, then you better damn know what it is. Like for me, like my belief is that when you use good organic practices, slow release fertilizers like TD and I both use, right, you have good biology, very important. You can't just have all the slow release stuff, good biology. Nature is self-balancing, right? And the soil knows where it needs to be, and it'll happen, because if it's too low, the bugs that eat the minerals that make it too low or too high will come in and they'll flourish to kind of bring it back into balance, as long as you're fighting a good environment, you know, and situation for them. So, I mean, that's kind of where I'm at. and it'll fall right in line to where it needs to be, you know. So that's my personal opinion. Of course, if you're staking your life on a grow, then you might want to check it. But you know, TD and I pretty much don't check ours, and things grow pretty good.
I do it for a passion. There's no money involved in it, so it's just a passion for me. Like, I'll be throwing away 7 of last year's here soon, so it's no big deal.
7 extra pounds.
Yep.
I see.
Dumping it.
Well, I'll take it.
The homeless.
I'll take some extra stuff. I could use it in some edibles. So you guys saw like a tour of all his plants in the update, but TD, if you just had to only pick one, because I know every year you like to try to like mix it up and grow new ones, but if you could only pick one of the girls that you grew this year, which one would you regrow and why? At this point, I mean, it might change, of course.
At this point, it would probably be the Glookies.
The Glookies.
I really, really like how she's doing. She's phenomenal structure. I like her structure. She really leans toward the indica side. She really does. And she doesn't have to have this like crazy rapid growth, but she just like has this big stretch that she does outward wise. And that's what I like, is really wide plants. So I would definitely probably go with Glookies as we speak.
Glookies as we speak, yeah, currently seeing.
If we get to flavor and we get down to the ones when they're harvested, and if they come out like they say, it might be the white runs. Because
even though, yeah, I mean, that's come back.
Yeah, that's supposed to taste really, really fruity. So, and she's a big girl too. She's not no little runt no more.
Yeah, no, your girls are quite big, man. All right, any final words of wisdom you want to share with my viewers today before we sign off?
Not really much what to say. We've pretty much covered a lot of topic. Again, there's not really much to cover at this stage of the game when they get like this, but the next time there will be. There'll be a lot of flowering. We're pretty much, like I said though, we're done with all nutrients, teas, everything. Just let everything ride it out. I know that I don't have a cover crop. You'll notice that this year. I never got around to it. I definitely will grow the winter wheat though and still cover crop. I know that I should still have it right now, but I don't, and I won't. Guaranteed.
Nope. Let's talk about beneficial insects. Did you put out the praying mantis eggs or get some lace wings like you're talking about?
I didn't even do either any of that this year. I got so wrapped up in that kitchen that I was
your remodel.
In. Yeah, so I had countertops coming. Now they've already been measured and stuff. So I finally I think 10 days ago, I finally got to come back out here. And there was like 2 days at a time that I wouldn't even hardly come out here.
Wow.
Kind of do a quick walkthrough going, oh God, I hope.
But when would you have put out the praying mantis and got the beneficials?
I would have done it about 4 weeks ago, because they take about 3 weeks to hatch, right? I think it's 3 weeks to hatch.
Depends on the weather.
Yeah, so right now would be a perfect time to have them crawling around and getting
out. Because you're not going to spray anymore, and they're literally your defense.
They're
because
my last
you're not
defense
spraying.
Weapon. Exactly.
Exactly.
But next year, for sure, I will get to those lace wings. We'll try those, because I want to try those.
Yeah, and even without using them, I mean, basically, from what I'm seeing, you don't even need them at this point.
Correct.
But it's always better be safe than sorry.
Yep.
Because you get an outbreak, and those praying mantises would have kicked their ass.
Yep, exactly.
Then you're going to be,
And it's funny, when I do plant those, even my neighbors call me up, hey, your buddies are escaping.
Because they're crawling over their neighbor's house.
They go to his garden. I guess he has more bugs.
Right. All right, so coming up in the next month, you're pretty much, until I come back, you're just basically watering every 3 days and just inspecting them, and that's pretty much it.
Yeah, we won't be doing anything else. Like I said, we gave them the banana tea. That's all I'm gonna do this year. I am gonna do one more feed of the milk, because
one
that's
more feed
sugar
of the milk.
I will go get another 100 gallons of milk and feed them one last time. That's just micro feeding though. That's not, you know,
it's not anything major.
Yeah,
I mean,
nothing.
Just basically like giving them some liquid. Yeah,
correct.
Some nutrients.
Yeah. Just one last little shirah and let her do her thing, and they should be well on their way. Their trunk's huge.
Yeah, sure. And then how many times did you feed the milk this season?
Oh, I'll bet you I did it 8 to 9 times.
Wow, yep. 8 to 9 times. So how often every week?
I bet you I gave them more milk than I did tea.
Really? So maybe that is the reason why they're so healthy.
I do know one thing though.
It
says it's supposed to help with the powder mildew. So we'll see if we get any powder mildew this year. Because I usually get a little. You know, like I said, after your third cut, you're susceptible.
Yeah,
because
it's like late.
Open.
It's so late.
Yeah, and everybody's open too. So you're weeping out the ends and stuff. So there's, and these plants grow with like a tube in the middle of them. I take them and make straws out of them. Straws for Josh and stuff. And he was like, oh, whoa.
We could sell your
cannabis
hemp straws and drink your sodas.
And they won't go halfway through a soda and
dissolve.
Be like paper. But no, So they have a hole, so they still weep no matter what. So you could get that powder mildew, but we're going to see if the milk will help prevent that. Even after the third cut. We'll get third cuts on a few of these, guaranteed. There's a few big plants in here again this year.
And right now, you know you're going to get at least like 6 to 7 pounds per plant, but you got to still wait to kind of see where it goes.
Yeah, how it irons out. See if they really, like the vanilla cream pies, they're going to do this like really weird flowering thing as opposed to what I've been seeing, because they're going to do like a small little bud here and then a stick off to the side with another little small bud. They're going to look kind of crazy as opposed to other plants. The new is going to grow colas. The white runts is going to grow some nice size buds, but not colas. So it all depends, you know. I've seen people are like, oh, that plant's not big enough to get 10 pounds. I personally have seen a 6 foot plant get 10 pounds. So you can kiss my ass when it comes to that. Because my buddy grew this 6 foot plant. It was only maybe 6.5 feet wide, but it grew rock hard flower. I mean, they were it's rock intense. Hard. I could have knocked you out with one. Just boom. So it all depends on the density of the flower in the end, not the size of the plant.
So how do you make more dense flowers?
Well, the banana's supposed to help, banana tea, so we'll find out. It's worked every year, so that's what I like to use at least. And next year, what I'm going to do in one of them, it's been recommended to me from one of my buddies, is that just take the banana peel and rip it in like little half-inch strings, or whatever you want to call it, strips, and plant it all over inside there. It just bury it. It's, you know, so it's it planted in with the feed that I do,
so it breaks
the lasagna feed. And so, yeah, it all breaks down at that time. And by the time that we get there, we won't even have to do the banana and everything will be in there.
Interesting.
Yeah, so then we'll make it to where we hardly have to do anything.
Cool.
And the ropes and the clothespins worked out like a champ this year. They really did. They're lost inside there, some of them.
Yeah, you can't even see them now. This is so green.
That's one thing about the green tape. At least you can find them.
All right, so that's pretty much it for this episode. If you guys enjoyed the TD episodes and want more episodes with TD and cannabis content on this channel, make sure you click that thumbs up. Let's me know that this content is wanted and desired by my viewers. I know some of you guys out there don't appreciate my cannabis content, but if you got this far in the video, I'm sure you do. So hey, click that like button, thumbs it up, and be sure to share this with others so that other people could be more familiar with how to grow cannabis outdoors organically and get insane amounts of yields. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss any of my new and upcoming episodes that come out every 5 to 7 days. Make sure you click the bell to get notified when my new video comes out with the next TD update so you guys can see how his grow is progressing. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes, including all the episodes I've made in the past, including the entire season 1. And all the episodes in season 2 up till now. Link is in the description for all the previous TD episodes where he shares his wealth of growing knowledge with you guys so you guys could grow the most amazing cannabis and make tons of flower yourselves. So with that, my name is John Cola with Growing Your Greens. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.